हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, वेलकम बैक. माय सेल्फ पुष्पेंद्र सिंह एंड वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट विद अवर डेली करंट अफेयर्स. सो दीज लेक्चर्स आर बेसिकली बेस्ड ऑन द करंट अफेयर्स विच आर यूजफुल फॉर योर सिविल सर्विसेज एग्जामिनेशन प्रिपरेशन एज वेल एज अदर गवर्नमेंट कॉम्पिटिटिव एग्जामिनेशंस. यू शुड ऑल्सो स्टडी अलॉन्ग विद दैट द नेशनल न्यूज पेपर्स लाइक द हिंदू और इंडियन एक्सप्रेस. Okay, I am also referring these newspapers here in these lectures. You can also refer these newspapers, which are very, very important. Apart from that, you can supplement your preparation with the help of these lectures. These lectures are uploaded on the YouTube on the day-to-day basis. So you can subscribe our channel on the YouTube for these lectures, right, which are uploaded on the YouTube on the day-to-day basis. All right, so let's begin with the lecture. Okay, so first is about the cyber crime volunteers, right? So here, first of all, let us understand what is that cyber crime volunteers. So volunteer, as you know, the person who is willing to give some contribution towards a agency, that is called volunteer. So volunteer is something which is, you know, by its own will, right? So the person who is willing to do certain work, right? Okay, so what is happening is that the Union Home Ministry basically have formulated a scheme or a program that is called Cyber Crime Volunteer Program. I'll come to that, what is Cyber Crime Volunteer Program, a bit later. So under which certain sections of the society or certain people in the society have been volunteered, right, to provide the Home Ministry some data related to, right, cyber crime on the net. As you know, in the public profiles, right, like Facebook, Twitter, lot of basically the cyber crime related activities are going on, right? So to keep an eye on that, to keep and tap on that, the government or the Home Ministry basically have formulated this program that is known as Cyber Crime Volunteer Program, right? Specifically for those public agencies or public sites, right, which are basically used, right, by the public, like Facebook and Twitter, for that purpose. Okay, so this volunteer program is basically supposed to act as a facilitative tool, as a facilitative tool between ordinary citizens as well as government. One side you have the ordinary citizens, another side you have the government, definitely for the prevention of a cyber crime. Okay, so recently the news has come that the Union Home Ministry has said that it does not maintain any sort of a centralized list of volunteers which are enrolled under cyber crime volunteer program. Because why the center has gave this statement? Because in the 7th schedule, which is basically the schedule of the constitution, which basically divides, right, you know, the subjects, right, between center and the states, and for that purpose a three lists are there. Okay, that is, first is called basically union list. Okay, second is called state list. Okay, and third is called basically your concurrent list. Okay, now as you already probably know that on the union list only center can legislate, on the state list in the normal circumstances, right, only the state can legislate, but in the case of emergency or in the case of abnormal circumstances, the union government or the central government can also legislate on the state list. And on the concurrent list, the items or the subjects, both the center and states can legislate both. In this case, only state in the normal circumstances, or in the union list, exclusively center can legislate on the union list. No matter what, the state cannot legislate on the union list. Now, this police, which is a state subject, have been placed under the state's list, right? That is why the center is saying that it has not maintained any sort of a the list which provide any sort of a, you know, the cyber crime, you know, the enrolled, which are enrolled under cyber crime volunteer program. Now through cyber crime grievances portal, which have been framed or which have been implemented by the Ministry of Home Affairs through cybercrime.gov.in, right, the purpose of this portal is basically to raise the group of cyber crime volunteers to definitely to flag some of the unlawful content which is lying on the internet, to track down, to put it down some of the unlawful content. I'll give you for example. For example, if you use a Facebook, Instagram, or Twitter, right? You know, there is, you know, the memes about the government policies, right? For even, you know, the couple of hundreds of the contract that you have signed, right, to be a volunteer for the Ministry of Home Affairs, right? You can basically support, right? You know, about any report or any, you know, post that have been imposed or that have been put on the Twitter, Facebook, or any sort of Instagram. So the ordinary citizens or normal citizens like us are being asked to judge if that particular post is threatening, right, the sovereignty of our nation, right, the public order of our nation, right, if that post is basically threatened our international relations or the child rights or the rights of any person, right, if that post is basically, you know, threatens the sovereignty, integrity, public order, international relations, child rights, or any sort of other, you know, the aspects related to the cyber crime, right, immediately the volunteer can alert basically the national level agency. Okay, so what is the volunteer program? It is, as I told you, it is supposed to act as a facilitative tool, right, between the ordinary citizens and your government for the prevention of cyber crime. Okay, what happens is any citizen can register themselves under one of the categories. So there are three categories basically on the portal if you visit them. First is basically the cyber volunteer unlawful content flagger. Okay, second is basically cyber awareness promoter, and the third is basically cyber experts. So I said three categories: cyber volunteer unlawful content flagger, those will basically flag the unlawful content. Second is cyber awareness promoter, who would basically promote some sort of a cyber awareness to the people, and cyber expert, who are basically experts in containing the cyber crime. So under these categories, the ordinary citizens can register and they can enroll as a volunteer. Okay, now, as I told you that it is basically consisting of a digital rights groups, right? The Internet Freedom Foundation, which is basically enabled the culture of, you know, the surveillance, right? This culture of surveillance by the ordinary citizen itself, with the help of the government, right? The digital rights groups basically also claim that, or various social rights groups or the human rights groups basically claim that it would create a social distrust in the society, right? Because why it will create the social distrust? Because if you are involving the people, like the common people, that may be my friend or my friend's friend, right? If I'm some sort of a, you know, putting some sort of a post against the government, right? Even the post which is against the government policies or some of the weaknesses, you know, if I'm showing some sort of a weaknesses of the government, my post may be shown as, you know, some sort of a, the post which may be putting the danger on the social, you know, harmony. So that may be basically encouraging some sort of a, you know, the social distrust in the social sphere. And in response to the RTI applications which have been filed, the total number of volunteers, right, who have applied under so cybercrime volunteer program, just now I explained to you, right, the ministry said that the information could be sought directly from the respective states and the union territory. Why the ministry has said? Because the central government knows that the police is basically an state subject. Now center has no role to play, only in the exception circumstances when the law and order situation is gone out of control, the center basically resists the, you know, the sum of the center paramilitary forces, right, which is also known as CRPF or CPF, right, for the purpose of assisting the police in the state. For example, if there is communal violence or if there is any sort of a, you know, the disaster and the police is unable to tackle that one, then the central government would basically assist the police of a state with some sort of a central paramilitary forces. Okay, otherwise the police is basically a state subject. The state is basically concerned about the law and order. Even law and order is also the state subject. So that is why the Union Home Ministry has categorically says that in the RTI application that you can ask this question about how many volunteers have been applied and how many volunteers have been rolled out, right, directly to the states or union territories, because we don't have such list, because the police is basically a state list under 7th schedule of the constitution. Okay, now some of the people basically claim that this program was expected to include the 500 volunteers, 200 cyber awareness promoters, and 50 cyber experts. Just now I have explained to you the under three categories, right? What are these three categories? Just now I explained you. First is basically the volunteers, which are cyber volunteer unlawful content flagger, cyber awareness promoters, basically who promote the awareness, and cyber experts, who are experts in some sort of a cyber related crimes. So here the National Cyber Crime Management Unit, right, which is basically mandated with to provide the cyber crime volunteer program, is basically constituted as a part of the Indian Cyber Crime Coordination Center scheme, which is launched by the Union Home Minister Amit Shah in January 2020. Okay, so what is that, the Indian Cyber Crime Coordination Center scheme? Okay, so first of all, now you must understand, the Indian Cyber Crime Coordination Center scheme is basically established under the Ministry of Home Affairs, right? The purpose of setting up of this Indian Cyber Crime Coordination Center scheme is to act as a nodal point at the national level. I'm talking about the national level, right? Definitely to fight against the cyber crime. The main purpose of this coordination center, right, to provide a platform so that it can be helpful in dealing with the cyber crimes in the coordinated and comprehensive manner, right? And the one of the most important objective of Indian Cyber Crime Coordination Center scheme is to create an ecosystem, right, that can bring the academias, industry, public, government, right, everyone, because it should be a coordinated approach. So it should bring every section of the society, academics, right, industry, public, government, so that you can prevent, you can detect, you can investigate, or you can prosecute these cyber crimes. All right. And one more important point is that this Indian Cyber Crime Coordination Center in the scheme has emphasized the cyber crime volunteer program that we are explaining just now. Okay. So this I4C, which is also known as Indian Cyber Crime Coordination Center scheme, has emphasized the cyber crime volunteer program to bring together citizens, right, who have passion, right, to serve the nation on this single platform, so that they can contribute to the nation regarding the information related to the cyber crime. All right, so any sort of a good smartian, right, who are willing to help in that process, right, they can register as a cyber crime volunteer as a under three categories, and they can basically work under this scheme. Okay, so the project was basically approved in October 2018, right? It has the estimated cost of around 415 crore rupees. Okay, and for that purpose, it also have other components, and for that purpose 69.8 crore rupees have been allocated in 2021-2022 budget, right, under Union budget I'm talking about. All right, so here you can see the one of the person who may be the cyber experts, who is basically resolving certain issues. Okay, next, liquid oxygen. As you know that the oxygen shortage have been going on in our country because of government mismanagement related to the oxygen availability in the hospitals, and it is a huge shock to the nation also, right, that the government is unable to maintain enough stock of the oxygen in the public hospitals or in the public, the healthcare facilities. And almost 1 year it could have easily managed, but it is simply a negligence from the government side, from the administration side, that the liquid oxygen or the vital oxygen is not available, which is a life saving specifically in this coronavirus. So a simple case of mismanagement, simple case of negligence, right? So the government, because of lot of people is dying under pressure, so they have invoked the Disaster Management Act. This Disaster Management Act basically this act was passed by the parliament in 2005, which basically provide certain powers to the central government to manage any sort of a disaster. This may be a disaster. So center has ordered under the Disaster Management Act that all liquid oxygens, right, which are existing stock with the private plants, should not be diverted for non-medical purpose. They only should be used for the medicinal purpose only, or for the medical purpose only. That means whatever the existing stocks are there with respect to the liquid oxygen, they would only be used, right, or they would only be available to the government, and that too they will be only used in the medical purpose. Okay, So regarding liquid oxygen, it is basically also called LOX or liquid oxygen. It is a simple, you can say, it is a fuel which is basically used in the aerospace engineering, in the aerospace, you know, applications, in the submarine applications, right? It is simply a liquid form of molecular oxygen. Okay. So regarding its chemical properties about liquid oxygen, so liquid oxygen is basically a pale blue colored, right? It's a gas, right? And it is strongly paramagnetic, and it can be suspended between the poles of powerful magnet. Now, what is this paramagnetic? See, paramagnetism is basically a form of magnetism. You might have studied also in your physics also, right? So it's a form of magnetism whereby, you know, some materials are weakly attracted by, you know, if you put any sort of externally applied magnetic field, any externally applied magnetic field, right? Some material who are paramagnetic, right? They are weakly attracted by external applied magnetic field. Okay. And, you know, and form some sort of a induced magnetic field in the direction of applied magnetic field. So that type of, you know, the behavior of that, you know, the materials are known as paramagnetic in the nature. Okay. Now, second is the liquid oxygen is also the cryogenic nature, right? The liquid oxygen can cause the materials it touches to become extremely brittle. So what is cryogenic? See, cryogenic in the physics, if you have studied, right, in engineering, you might have studied also what is cryogenics. See, cryogenics is basically a production and the behavior of a material at a very low temperature. That means it's a simply an application, right, of a material, how it behaves, and it's a production, right, of a material at a very, very low temperature, right? And the liquid oxygen also is a very powerful oxidizing agent also, right? And the organic materials will burn rapidly and energetically in the liquid oxygen. So what is oxidizing agent? Already all you know about in your chemistry, you might have studied in your 11th and 12th class also. So in any oxidizing agent, right, which is in substance, right, that has an ability to oxidize other substance. So that means if an oxidizing agent is there which can oxidize another substance, so in other words, what you can say that it basically having that, you know, ability to accept their electrons, so it can accept others' electron. So commonly oxidizing agents are basically, you know, oxygen or the hydrogen peroxide H2O2 or even halogens, right? They are the strong, you know, basically oxidizing agents which are found in nature. Okay. So here you can see the liquid oxygen. Okay. Next, the marive. First of all, what is marive? See, marive is basically a capital city of the marive governorate, which is basically lying in the basically country of Yemen. Now, what is happening is that I'll tell you a brief introduction about the Marif. See, in the Yemen, there is, you know, a civil war is going on basically, right? So what is happening is that, right, there are Houthi rebels. These Houthi rebels are basically backed by the Iran. They are backed by the Iran, right? They have, right, rebelled against the government and government military. So what happens is there is one-sided. The Yemen government, which is backed by the Saudi Arabia, listen carefully. There is one side, you have the Yemen government, which is backed by the military and the Saudi led alliances, right? Another side, you have the Houthi rebels, which are backed by the Shia Iran government. So Houthi rebels are basically backed by the Shia Iran governments. Now what is happening is there is a fight in the Yemen between the government forces as well as between these Houthi rebels. These Houthi rebels has taken over the control of, you know, the northwestern Kasara battlefield, which is very close to the center of the Marif city, which is basically a capital of the Marif governorate in the Yemen. Okay. Now, why the Marif is most important? Because it was the capital of ancient kingdom of Saba. I'll let you know what is the kingdom of Saba, right? And why this the Saudi is basically interested in this kingdom of Saba, right? I'll let you know. So the scholars basically believe that the ancient Saba is basically having some sort of a biblical fame, and it is basically located nearby your Sarawak mountain. So what is that you know, why the ancient, you know, the historians believe that it is a capital of ancient kingdom of Sava, which is we call the Meriv nowadays. See, that the kingdom of the Sava, or the believers of the kingdom of Sava who have support of, or who supported this kingdom of Sava, is known as the Savaians, or simple you can say they are called Savaians. They were basically the ancient Arabian people of Saudi Arabia. Listen carefully. They were ancient Arabian people of Saudi Arabia. Now they speak different language that are known as Savaians language, because you know they were basically founded by the kingdom of Sava, which are believed to be the oldest and the most important Saudi Arabian or South Arabian kingdoms. And that is the reason the Saudi Arabia, which is basically is more interested in this, basically in this fight. And what is this Sharawat mountain? See, Sharawat mountain is also known as sometimes Sharat, okay, in Yemen. And it is basically a mountain range, which is basically in the western part of Arabian Peninsula. If you see, you know, basically your physical map, you can easily find out the Arabian Peninsula, right? So in the western part of this Arabian Peninsula, you will find basically the Sharat mountains or Sharawat mountains. Okay, so if you see, they are basically running parallel to the east coast of Red Sea. You can easily find the east coast of the Red Sea. So running parallel to that, they are called basically, you know, your Sharawat mountains. Okay, now let us go behind a brief history about these Houthi rebels. I'll let you know a brief about. See, this Houthi movement or Houthi rebels basically, they started emerging after, you know, the Yemen's north province, which is known as Sada. Right. So what happens is, as you know, the Yemen is also bordered with the Saudi Arabia. Right. It is landlocked, and which has led to the complex warlike situation. And definitely these, you know, this fight, which is basically backed by the US and Saudi led alliances or coalition. So definitely one side you have the US and Saudi led alliances, right? The influence basically grown regarding this Houthi rebels, basically, you know, challenging the former president, whose name was the Ali Abdullah Saleh, in 2004, right? Which were basically taken then capital of Sana'a, right? And then the much of this fight basically started after 2014, okay? So which war basically related to the war in the Yemen, which was basically led, one side you have the Saudi led alliance, another side you have basically, you know, the Iran, and basically you have, you know, some of the Saudi led alliance basically have also claimed that the Houthi supporters are basically supported by, you know, by the Tehran, and Tehran rhetoric is basically firmly the pro Houthi. And experts also pointed out that the Iran's basically designs and technology is being used in Houthi missile attacks. So how could the Houthis got these technology and these designs? Definitely would have backed by the Iran or Tehran, and all sort of a drone designs and all sort of a having some sort of a linkages with the Tehran. Okay, so Houthi insurgency in the Iran was also known as Houthi rebellion, which is a basically a military rebellion, definitely, right? And it was started specifically in the northern Yemen, and it was now escalated to the full-fledged war. Okay, so this Meriv and the surrounding oil field, right, which is basically also the most economic, you know, the area also in terms of the production of oil. So it has the largest pocket of government held territory also in the north. And now if that Meriv is also gone under the rebel control, right, that would be basically, you know, some sort of the great loss to the Yemen government also. So definitely the loss of the Meriv would be a major blow to the Yemeni government as well as the Saudi led alliances also. Now the Saudi Arabia has also supported its military, right, since March 2015 after the rebels basically captured the Sana'a, which was the capital, and it was basically supported by the Saudi led, you know, alliances. So now here we are talking about the Meriv. Here you can say, you know, the Arabian Peninsula, and in that you can basically find the Sana'a, which was captured by, you know, the Houthi rebels, and now the Mariv is also going to be captured by the Houthi-led, alliances. And now this Mariv is basically capital of the Mariv governorate, which is a part of your Yemen. And now in Yemen, you have the full-fledged civil war between the Houthi-led, your rebels, as well as one side you have the Yemen government, which is backed by the Saudi Arabia and the US and other allies. Okay. Next, Rajan Mishra. Who was the Rajan Mishra? See, Rajan Mishra was basically a classical singer. He was the classical singer, and recently he died because of coronavirus or COVID-19 related complications. Now, the Rajan Mishra, why he is known as the classical singer? Because he belonging to the Banaras Gharana, right? The Rajan Mishra along with the brother Sajan Mishra have performed both Indian and the global audiences for decades now. Specifically, they have given contribution to the classical music. Now, they were also renowned vocalist for the Khyal style of Indian classical singing. I'll come to that, what is that Gharana and all sort of things, right? And both of the brothers, your Sajan Mishra and Rajan Mishra, both of these brothers have already been honored by the Padam Bhushan Award, right? They were also awarded the Sangeet Natak Academy Award as well as the Gandharva National Award, right? Definitely for their contribution specifically in the classical music, okay? Now, let us understand what is that Banaras Gharana. And first of all, let us understand what is Gharana. Then we'll come to that Banaras Gharana. See, Gharana is simply in the simply language, you can say simply a family, or you can say it is a lineage. Okay. Now, in the Hindustani music, what you say that the Gharanas are most popular. You can easily find out. So what is that Gharana? You can say they are the family or lineages, or simply you can say they are the community of performers, right? Who basically shares a distinctive musical style. Okay, distinctive musical style, and that basically having some lineages or some traces to the particular instructor or to the particular region. That means a distinctive musical style of a particular person that have been traced with some sort of a particular instructor of a region. So that means the system of Gharana is a means by which the musicians, right, could maintain their artistic authority, right? And they can emphasize of the lineages, right? Definitely, when you have, some sort of a patronage from the courts in the pre-independence era, when the Britishers basically used to rule, even before Britishers, right? And the members of Gharana basically are entrusted with the maintenance of certain standards of the musicianship, right? And which is definitely accordance with the lineages in which they have belongs to, okay? And how could these gharanas and their traditions have been basically propagated since the generations together? So first of all, traditionally the students or the disciples, right, they were basically along with the teachers, which helped to ensure the integrity of these musical traditions or this musical transfer from the one generation to the another generation. So the gharanas could be existed for both vocal and the instrumental traditions, first of all. And the Gwalior, which was also in the Madhya Pradesh right now, the Gwalior, you have the vocal gharana, right? And which is widely regarded as the oldest gharana in India, right? And now one such gharana is also known as Banaras Gharana, which is Banaras is basically a city in Uttar Pradesh. Okay, so I was talking about him. He is also known as Rajan Mishra, who has recently been died because of the coronavirus complications. Okay. Next, the deep time study. So first of all, let me give you a brief introduction about the deep time study, then we'll go. See, some of the scientists from basically the Human Adaptation Institute. The Human Adaptation Institute, which is basically located in France, okay, have basically, adopted this deep time project, project or deep time study, a project. Now, why this deep time study project was basically adopted by the scientists from the Human Adaptation Institute? Because they want to check, first of all, what is that deep time study? So the scientists from the Human Adaptation Institute, basically, they have gone into the cave, cave, right? Inside the cave for 40 days, right? You know, and exploring how the limits of the human adaptability to the isolation. That means they have gone themselves, they have put themselves in the isolation in the cave to check how the limits of the human adaptability can function in such isolated environment inside the cave for 40 days. Now they have come out from the cave after 40 days, which is so-called the deep time experiment, which was conducted by the scientists from the Human Adaptation Institute, which is basically located in the France. And in that 40 people, okay, there were 8 men, 7 women, right, which were basically took part to leave the cave. Okay, so sorry, it was basically belongs to the 15 such people, and they have gone inside the cave for 40 days. So the 40 is basically days, and there were 15 people. In the 15 people, there were 8 men and 7 women. They have went inside the cave for isolation for around 40 days to check the limits of human adaptability, right? So 15 participants basically took part, right, in this basically cave. That cave is known as Lombrives cave, which is basically located in the southwest France, right? They have gone inside this Lombrives caves without phones, clocks or sunlight. Okay, so and inside the caves also they slept in the tents. They made their own electricity, right? They have no contact with the outside world because they have no phones as such inside the cave. And the project is basically, you know, aimed to test how the people respond, right? You know, if they lose their sense of the time and the space, right? If somehow you send to yourself, you know, or some people were sent to some other, you know, planet or something had gone wrong, and you lose the sense of time and the space, how would you respond, right? To check the human adaptability in such isolation, this project was basically starting. Okay, now during such isolation, what happens is, you know, the groups or the people who were basically there, right, they were basically organized certain groups in the groups. Okay, now these groups were basically gone inside, you know, the cave to check the human adaptability inside the cave. And definitely you have to measure the time to create the deadliness. Okay, now they have to rely on their body clocks and the sleep cycles to structure their days, because they have no such clocks also. Okay, and they have only few modern comfort at their disposal, right? For example, they were also generating their own electricity with the pedal bike. Okay, and they don't have the water, so they basically draw this water from the deep well, that is 45 meter, around 146 feet below the earth. They were also drawing the water for the drinking and for other purpose for 40 days together. All right, so these were the volunteers who were basically took part in this expedition. Okay, next you have the news related to Asia. Now the Asian, as you know, about basically, you know, the Asian is basically the association of Southeast Asian nation. It is an association for the Southeast Asian nation. I'll come to that a bit later. First let us understand why this Asian is the news. So already all you know about, there is a political crisis in the Myanmar. The Myanmar is a country in the Asian region. Okay, now there is a political crisis in the Asian, in the Myanmar region. So first time the foreign ministers of the Asian countries, they have met in the Indonesia, okay, to resolve the political crisis in the Myanmar. Okay, now these foreign ministers of the Asian region basically have urged the Myanmar army general, you know, the Min Aung Hlaing have taken over the basically administration of Myanmar in the political crisis, right? And the Asian foreign ministers have urged that the general Min Aung Hlaing to end the violence crackdown in the country and urgently released the political prisoners, you know, that the general have taken into the custody. Okay, now let us understand in briefly about the political crisis in the Myanmar, right? So first of all, the political crisis in the Myanmar was started in the morning, February 1st, 2021. Okay, listen carefully. In February 1st, 2021, the political crisis was started. Now, what happens is there was an election and the democratically elected, you know, represented, right? So, democratically elected leader, right? They were basically belongs to the ruling party that is known as NLD. So, NLD means the National League for the Democracy, which is, you know, the democratic leader, right, is also a part of that party, which was also ruling party at that point of the time. Now, that was deposed, right, that was deposed, that was removed by the Myanmarese military at that 1st February 2021. And that was basically, you know, what happens is that basically immediately imposed the state of emergency. Okay. And the Myanmar army has also declared by imposing this state of emergency that all the powers now will be transferred in the basically the commander in chief. The commander in chief of defense services. Okay. The commander in chief of the defense services at that point of the time was General Min Aung Hlaing. Right. He was the commander in chief. So all power which was belongs to the democratically elected members or the ruling party or the government have transferred to the commander in chief of defense services by imposing, right, the year long state of emergency after deposing the government of Myanmar. So what happens is, why this has done? Because now let us go understand a big background also. In November 2020, a general election was basically held. Okay, in the general election, they were basically declared, or their results were declared invalid with the support of Myanmar's army. So the result was declared invalid, right? Definitely there was intent to hold the new elections, definitely to end the state of emergency, right? And you must also understand that most of the people in the Myanmar was basically satisfied with this results of that was happened in the general election in November 2020. But that political crisis that was loomed in the Myanmar, right, just before the parliament of Myanmar was due to swear these new members that were basically elected in this November 2020, right? So why this political crisis was there and why this imposition of the national emergency was imposed? So that it can prevent the new members from taking the seats in the parliament of Myanmar. And that was the reason the president of Myanmar, Mr. Win Myint, he was the president of Myanmar at that point of the time, and state councillor Miss Aung San Suu Kyi was also detained, right? And other ministers, the deputies and member of parliament, they were all detained before just they swear in the new parliament. All right, so they were basically, you know, a coup which was done by the General Min Aung Hlaing. Okay, now let us understand about the ASEAN. As I told you, the ASEAN stands for the Association for Southeast Asian Nations. Okay, now it is a political and economic union which basically consisting of the 10 Asian countries. Okay, the main purpose of the Association of the Southeast Asian Nation is basically to promote the economic growth, to promote the political stability, right, of definitely of the individual countries, and definitely to promote the regional stability in the Asian region. Or apart from these promoting economic growth, political stability and the regional stability, they also focus on the social progress, the socio-cultural evolution among the members, right? And they also, you know, promote some sort of a mechanism or strategy to promote these harmony among the nations to resolve some of the differences peacefully without any violence. Regarding the ASEAN was formed in 1967 by basically five countries: Thailand, Singapore, Philippines, Malaysia and Indonesia. But what happens is, over the period of the time, five more members were basically also involved or also given the membership of ASEAN. So their membership was also extended to include five more members: Vietnam, Myanmar, Laos, Cambodia and Brunei. Right now you have 10 members in the ASEAN region, and secretariat for the ASEAN region is located in the Jakarta, which is basically in the Indonesia. All right. So it is basically, you know, a logo of Asia. Now, Oxygen Express. As you know, the Oxygen Express is basically name which is given to the train which carry the oxygen, basically trucks or oxygen, you know, vehicles basically, and transporting from one region to the another region. So that train is known as Oxygen Express. So as you know, the second wave of Corona 19 or COVID 19 is basically going on, and there is huge mortality in that process, because there is the non-availability of the oxygens, specifically in the healthcare facilities. It is because simply case of mismanagement and the negligence part of the governance as well as the administration. They have given the ample time by the corona, but they have not yet proactively taken the step to save the life of the people, common citizens, and now the common citizens are dying in the absence of the oxygens, right? So now the hospitals are physically facing the massive shortage of medical oxygen, right? For that purpose, you know, an oxygen express basically carrying the tankers, which is filled with the liquid medical oxygen, basically, you know, first such oxygen express was basically, you know, have basically gone from the Vishakhapatnam, which is basically having the steel plant, and this oxygen express has reached to the Maharashtra on April 23rd. So in order to meet this high demand of the critical gas, which is meant for the treating of the coronavirus patient, because now they are facing very difficulty. Okay, so railway has started this oxygen express to transport the tankers from one region to the another region. So nowadays, the government has put every steel plants, which were basically previously, right, generating the another gases, also now they have pressed to the service to generate only the liquid oxygen, and that too only for the medicinal purpose, that too only for the medical purpose. So you can see here the basically oxygen express carrying the tankers, which are filled with the liquid medical oxygen for the medical supply to save the lives of the COVID-19 patients, which are very, very critical. Okay, next, Mahavir Jayanti. Okay, as you know, the Mahavir Jayanti was celebrated recently, right? On the birth anniversary of 24th of the Tirthankar, which was also the last Jain Tirthankar, Lord Mahavir. Okay, Prime Minister Narendra Modi basically greeted the people on the occasion of Mahavir Jayanti, right, which was the Lord Mahavir is also known as Mahavir Janma Kalyanak also, right? So in the Gregorian calendar, the holiday basically occurs either in March or in the April, and it is a most important festival or an event for the Jains, specifically, which is a religion. Okay, the followers of these Jains or the Lord Mahavir basically celebrate this festival, right, by chanting the prayers in the temples, offering the prasad to the devotees, and participating in the chariot processions also. Now let us understand a brief about Lord Mahavir. Okay, then we'll move further. So Lord Mahavir was basically the 24th, you know, Tirthankar. You can say Tirthankar means a guru of Jainism. So he was the last and 24th Tirthankar of Jainism. And he was born on 13th day of rising moon of Chaitra month. So it was in the according to a Gregorian calendar, he was born on the 13th day of rising moon of Chaitra month at Bihar in India. So he was born in Bihar, and Lord Mahavir was basically born in the royal family. He was born in the royal family, and he was given the name of Bardhaman because of the increased prosperity in the kingdom during his birth, right? So that Bardhaman was given because of that purpose. So, you know, the Jainism or separate set of religion or Jainism was basically founded by the Mahavira or Bardhamana in basically around in 6th BC. Okay, so it can basically formed by the Mahavira, who was also contemporary of Buddha. Mahavira was basically born in 599 BC and he died in 527 BC. At that point of the time also, you know, the Gautam Buddha was also born. So Mahavira and Gautam Buddha both were basically contemporary. So you can understand he was basically involved in the setting up of the new religion, which is also known as Jaina. Right now, by the Mahavira is known as Jina. What is Jina? So first of all, let us understand why we call the Mahavira as a Jina. So at the age of 30, Lord Mahavira renounced means completely left the worldly life, right? And the Lord Mahavira become ascetic, sadhu ban gaya, theek hai? And for next 12 years, that means up to the age of 42 years, right? He held the life of penance and complete meditation, nothing else, right? And he was at the end of these 12 years, he was basically credited to have conquered all his desires, right? And he was came to known as Jina. He was came to known as Jina, or simply Jina means you can say conqueror. Conqueror. What is conqueror? Why we call it Jina? Because he have conquered, right, his all desires. And all its followers, or all the followers of Lord Mahavira, who was also the 24th Tirthankara, they were came to be known as Jinas, or simple, they were called as Jains. So simple, the Jainas or Jinas were basically the conquerors of their all desires. So Mahavira has already conquered their desire, and that was the name. The Jina was basically originated from such the conquering of the desires, and the followers of this Lord Mahavira, they were came to known as Jains, and that is how the name basically originated. All right, I hope it is very clear. So you can see here the Lord Mahavira statue. Okay, PM Care Fund, right? Now, as you know, that PM Care Fund is basically, you know, it basically set up as, you know, the Prime Minister Citizen Assistance Relief in the Emergency Situation Fund, which is also in short known as PM Cares, on 27th March 2020, when the COVID-19 pandemic was basically grown in India, right, to get the donations for meeting the pandemic related expenses. So here, the Prime Minister Narendra Modi have ordered the setting up of 551 oxygen plants inside the government hospitals across the country, right? So definitely they will be set up in the districts, right, across the country in the government hospitals. When the people started dying after the shortage of oxygen, right, and it's a simple mismanagement and the negligence that the government was not proactively acting. Had it been acted at least 6 months before or 5 months before, right, they would have saved the precious life of the people. Now thousands of the people are dying every day in the absence of oxygen. Okay, so PM Care Fund will provide the financial aid to setting up of these plants. Okay, so let us understand first of all Prime Minister Citizen Assistance Relief Emergency Situation Fund. So it was a fund that was created on 27th March 2020, right, in the backdrop of the COVID-19 pandemic in India. Okay, the main purpose of the PM Care Fund is to provide a fund to combat and to contain, you know, the pandemic, to provide a relief effort against the coronavirus outbreak, right, and similar pandemic in the future also. And you must also understand that the documentation for the constitution of this fund has not been made public, first of all. And the government of India has stated that the Prime Minister of India, Mr. Narendra Modi, is a basically chairperson of the fund. So PM itself, or PM himself, is a basically chairperson of PM Cares Fund. And it has also trustees. This trustee involve the Minister of Defense, Mr. Rajnath Singh, the Minister of Home Affairs, Mr. Amit Shah, and the Minister of Finance, Ms. Nirmala Sitharaman. So it has the three trustees, the Minister of Defense, Minister of Home Affairs, and the Minister of Finance, and it has been chaired by the Prime Minister Narendra Modi. Now, why this PM Care Fund is basically, you know, is basically facing criticism? Because it has lot of the transparency issues, and under RTI Act also it has been made that certain information is not being given, and whatever the amount which have been donated, right, you know, the names of the donors are also not being publicly disclosed. And the most pressing the point of the PM Care Fund is basically it is being privately audited. Why the government is not auditing this fund on the, you know, by the public auditors? Why private auditors have been used, and why the donors, their names have not been disclosed to the public? These are the two bone of contention, right, before the people. The objective of this fund is basically to combat, to contain the, you know, the coronavirus, as well as to provide the relief effort related to this pandemic in the future as well as in the present. So as I told you, the Prime Minister Narendra Modi is basically chairperson. It has the three trustees, the Minister of Home Affairs, the Minister of Defense, and the Minister of Finance. And it has been filled through the donations, and these donations are basically exempted from the Income Tax Act under Section 18G. Okay, agricultural export. So India has recorded basically 30% increase in the agricultural export in India in 2020-21. If you compare with 2019-20 figure with 2020-21, there is 30% increase in the agricultural export despite of the coronavirus situation. So this year in 2020-21, 1.3 lakh crore rupees of the export business have been recorded. If you just see in the last year 2019-20, it was 1.11 lakh crore rupees export business. So it is around 30% increase in the agricultural export. And this pandemic is providing the opportunity to India to provide the reliable food and the nutritional support to the world in terms of the agricultural export. And even the APIDA chairman, APIDA means the, you know, the full form of APIDA, basically agricultural and processed food products export development authority. Chairperson Mr. M. Angamuthu has also recently said that there are 40% increase in the exports of the organic products this year. That means in 2020-21, there was 40% increase when compared to 2019 and 20. Okay. The APIDA chairman, Mr. M. Angamuthu, have basically, you know, recently been held this statement. Okay. And Mr. M. Angamuthu also said that there is a huge demand for the herbal and the medicinal, you know, products in the Europe, in the US, in the Middle East, as well as the APIDA is providing all sort of options to provide that support. So let us understand in briefly what is APIDA. So APIDA, as I told you, that APIDA means the Agricultural and the Processed Food Products Export Development Authority. It has been established by the Government of India under the Agriculture and Processed Food Products Export Development Authority Act that was passed by the Parliament in 1985. That means it is a statutory body because it has been formed with the help of the act which have been passed by the Parliament in 1985. So Agricultural and Processed Food Products Export Development Authority, or APIDA, is an apex export trade promotion active government body which has been set up by the Ministry of Commerce and Industry. It has not been set up by the Ministry of Agriculture. Now you must understand, it has set up by the Ministry of Commerce and Industry, Government of India, definitely under the, you know, under the name of Agriculture and Processed Food Products Export Development Authority. All right. So that's all for today. Thank you very much. We will meet again tomorrow for our next current affairs. Take care of yourself because of Corona. Thank you very much.